Hi everybody. Today we're gonna start our new series called StAsk, where we would be asking different statistical, mostly fundamental questions, and together we will try to find the answers to these tricky questions. And the first thing that I want to start is why p-values are uniformly distributed under null hypothesis. Long time ago, when I was young student and I have heard about this problem, I first thought about, so just usual case of observations, then p-values calculations, etc., etc. But no, then I understood that you are saying, guys, about distribution of p-values, but not calculation of p-values corresponding to some distribution. So today, I want to go with you through this topic, and briefly, we will talk about essence of p-values. We will proceed to the point of how exactly to get the distribution of p-values, and then we will shortly understand why p-values are uniformly distributed under null hypothesis is true. So let us begin. And to begin with essence of p-values, I guess the best place to go to is New York City, because there are a lot of skyscrapers in this town. And this one, maybe you know it, this is Empire State Building. And if you go around the New York City, you can find more skyscrapers, and I would say even more. So when you encounter different skyscrapers, sometimes you're asking yourself, oh gosh, this skyscraper is so big. I don't know, can I even dream of encountering and seeing even bigger one? When you are saying this, you mean like bigger one? Or sometimes you are thinking about even smaller one if you're encountering some really small skyscraper, yeah? But this is all when talking corresponding to some mean, to some expected skyscraper, because we are usually surprised when we encounter something truly enormous, yeah? Something that is out of the average, out of our average expectations. And then this is the question that we are formulating when we are asking about the p-values. Like, what is the probability to encounter as high or as low skyscraper as, for example, this one here, comparing with the mean, that is this one. And you can ask me, how did I know that this one is mean? So I have just made a trick of ordering the skyscrapers. So let's imagine that this is all our observations that we have. This is all our even population. And then this skyscraper occurs to be the main one. So this stays in the middle. And this one, we suddenly encounter it. And then to answer to this question about p-value, like what is the probability to encounter as extreme or even more extreme observation, we just need to understand how far we are from mean. And we see that this one and this one and this one, they're as extreme or more extreme from the mean. And if we're going to the opposite direction, then here we would be talking about this one, and this one, just because they are on the same distance from our mean, from our expectation. And then if we just sum up like 3 and 3 and divide by whole total number like 10, then we would simply understand that we have like really good probability. We have like about 60% probability to get that extreme like this or even more extreme. So this is in fact the essence of p-value. So p-value would just simply tell us how is it likely that we would be shocked as much as we are now shocked or even more. But later in our discussions, I suggest to talk about one-tailed case instead of two-tailed. So previously on this example, we were talking to you also about this part, but now I don't want to take it into consideration because it is just enough to take about one part, and the second one, it would just only make our computation more complicated, yeah? But here we would be just answering to the question like, what is the probability to encounter as extremely high, but not just as extreme, okay? So these were the main essence of p-values. And after now we understand more or less what is p-value, we need to get like how to get this distribution of p-values. So if you Google a bit and find information about New York City, then you would find out that there are about 620 buildings with height greater than 50 meters. Yeah, somebody might say that it should be like 100 meters of height in order to be considered as a skyscraper, but as of now, let's assume 50 meters. And in Python, I have just plotted all of them here, all they are. These are how they are distributed. So I have a prime belief that my height distribution is like a normal one with parameters 150, like the expectation of the height, and 32 as a variance. And given this, given this prior belief, I can then calculate a p-value. And at this point, you might reasonably ask me, like, how did you get this particular distribution? How did you get this normal of 150 and 32? Well, this is just because this is my prior belief, so meaning that according to some information from the public sources, I know that, for example, in general, in USA, the skyscrapers, they are having this distribution. So the population of the skyscrapers in the USA, they're distributed like this. And now I just have this assumption that, okay, so New York is a part of the USA, so why skyscrapers should be distributed otherwise? So let us just take this belief. And now I would be just taking each value from here. I would be find corresponding position here, like this. And then I would be looking like, what is the area on the right? So meaning like, what is the probability to encounter as extremely high building or even more extreme? And obviously in this case, as this is here, the PDF, it is normalized by one. So I mean that just having the information about the area under this part of the curve is enough to get the probability itself. So that is the way how we would calculate the p-value. After that, as a result of making this calculation on each observation, we would get the distribution of p-values. So here it is on the right. This is our initial distribution of values of observations, and these are the p-values. And some of you might look at this and understand that, Jesus, it really reminds something like a uniform one. So it's not totally uniform just because we have only 600 observations, but it is quite close to something that we can call uniform. So now the question, weren't you expecting something like this soon? Because when I was young and I was asking myself this question, I was thinking, okay, it is very logical, for example, that we have this kind of distribution here, and then we need to make projection, and then we're making projection. In case of p-values, now we're making projection here. So just simply because it is vice versa, yeah? The closer we are to this end, the higher the p-value is. And then simply we're getting like that many p-values. Yeah, let's say that this is the distribution of p-values, so meaning that at this point, we should have that many p-values. Then at this point, we should have the maximum number of p-values just simply because here we have the maximum number of observations concentrated around this particular height. So why shouldn't then we just have like at the same position, almost the same number, almost the same density of the p-values? So from my point of view, In this question, this is the main logical trap that you might come into. And now our aim is to understand why it is just a trap and why, in fact, p-values are uniformly distributed under null hypothesis is true for any distribution. So you take any distribution and its p-values would be uniformly distributed. So let us take a look. And the key thing here is to understand what does this phrase mean that null is true. And null hypothesis is true if the sample is coming from prior distribution we trust in. So as I told you that I'm having a prior belief about the skyscrapers in New York City based on a priori information of the skyscrapers in the USA. And if it is so, if we truly have like the same distribution of skyscrapers in New York as in whole the United States, then the null is true. This is what it means, in fact. But if it is so, and null is true, then it matters how we're making these calculations and how we're making this shift. And it is important just to have these shifts to the right, as I have been showing to you, in terms of observations, like here, to be with, done with the same pace as in case of the null distribution. So what I mean, let us assume that we were leading here, so we were calculating p-values, and at some point here, we understand that we reach the 25th percentile. So here we have like 25% of the data behind. And now I'm asking, like, what is the p-value of this observation that is coming into the 25th percentile? And if we were doing everything correctly and we were following our null distribution, then it should mean that here we went absolutely the same path. So it means that here it should be absolutely the same 25% of the data. That applies that here you have the rest 75% of data, and this is exactly your p-value. And you can guess that it would be the same, for example, if I come at some point to, I don't know, 70th percentile. So here it would be 70. So meaning that here I would have p-value of 30. And that is it. So in case of p-value, obviously it would be like 0.3 because we're doing not in percent, but nonetheless. So it means that having the same pace, in fact, give us this possibility to convert our percentiles into the p-values. And what I now suggest you to do is to check this logic by using the property of the uniform distribution. Does it mean that I have answered all your questions? I don't think so, because you might ask me, for example, what happens if the null is not true? And in fact, it is so, because in New York, on average, I know it for sure, and I have checked it in different sources, the skyscrapers, they are a little bit higher. So on average, they're a little bit higher. So here, the expectation would be about 165, having absolutely the same variance. And I would suggest you to try to then understand what would be the distribution of p-values in this particular case. So I can tell you one thing, that for sure it would be non-uniform, but which one it would be and how to measure with it, I suggest you to check up this link. So here you would find this lovely quiz about the topic why p-values are uniformly distributed under null hypothesis. And I think that there are still a couple of questions left. So for example, does it work only for normal distribution? And I find this question quite reasonable, but I don't think that it is quite complicated, because now the only thing that you need to ask yourself is, was I using anywhere the property of normality? Or even was I using anywhere the case that the normal distribution is symmetric. And the second question is, does it work for two side p-values? The answer is absolutely for sure yes. And here, the answer is no, because no, it doesn't work only for normal distribution, it works for any distribution. But in case of two side p-values, yes, it would be absolutely the same. The only thing that would come as an obstacle is that you would need to make like two times more calculations, both for the right tail and for the left tail, but the logic would stay absolutely the same. You can say, what for do we need a distribution of p-values? It's really fine to know that it is uniform, but what for do we need it? Well, I can tell you, for example, that test for uniformity can help you to understand if the null is true or not. But trust me, this is very costly. So yes, you would compare the distribution of your p-values to the uniform one. And for example, you would understand that no, it's not uniform, meaning that the null is not true, then there is an alternative hypothesis that is true. But look, we have like general approach of the, let's say, hypothesis testing, yeah, when we're getting some empirical distribution, then we have like some mean calculation, and then we're calculating p-value once. P-value one time calculation. But here, in our approach, so this is the second approach, the approach with this calculation and getting the uniformity test. What we would need to do is to calculate p-value for each of the values. And imagine that the values are not about 600. Imagine that there are much more. So this method would be that much times more complex than this one. It's definitely a serious drawback of this method, even though somebody might tell you that, oh, for this method, you need quite a lot of data. Okay, it would be like computationally expensive, but still it would be more reliable because you would need more data. And when you have more data, your methods are more reliable. That was, in fact, the stuff about p-values. And if you like this video, for sure, please put the thumbs up, ask me something in the chat. And if you are already a little bit fed up with stuff in the chat, then I suggest you to join my new project that is called Study Platform, where you can find buddies for study, because I assume that nobody should stay alone on the way to new discoveries. So thank you very much once again, and see you.